Hello and welcome to Honey Badger Radio. Tonight's topic is Ask Karen Strawn Anything. How are you doing, Karen?
I'm doing all right. It's a blizzard here. The roads are just gross. There's going to be another maybe 10 centimeters of snow before we're all done. But it ain't Buffalo snow, so...
Actually, I have family out in Buffalo.
Yeah, we've lucked out in that regard, but it's like freezing with the wind chill. It's like minus 40. That's where Celsius and Fahrenheit shake hands and go each, you know, their own way. It's just really nasty and disgusting out there. The mailman refuses to come to my house because I haven't shoveled my walk yet. But other than that, everything's wonderful. The furnace is still working, so it's great.
Yeah. We've got so many questions. I don't even know where to begin. I think maybe we should just break the ice a little bit. I don't know. I don't know.
I'm kind of dreading, like, what kind of questions are we talking about? It's like...
Well, most of them don't seem to be anything weird. They just seem to be involved. So I think I'll read this question because this person expressed that they've posted a similar question multiple times. It says, every time Honey Badger posts a video asking subscribers to ask a question, whatever question, I always ask the same question, and I never get an answer. What if gender equality was a lie? What if men and women were not equals, and they weren't even supposed to be equals in the first place? I'll add a second and more specific question to explain my point of view and the reason for my first question. Can a truly gender egalitarian society be built completely and only gender, while the other gender only cares about positions of leadership and power? Which sounds like apartheid in South Africa, where blacks had to build white supremacists were only interested in positions of power and leadership. Who knows? Maybe this time I'll be lucky and my question will finally get an answer.
Okay, well, your question can't get an answer until I understand what your idea or what your definition of equal is. If your definition of equal is same, then no, an equal society, equality between the genders is impossible and it will always be impossible. Even if we were 100% psychologically and physically the same in all of our capabilities and preferences and all of those things, the fact that women give birth and men do not would impose inequalities on, you know, between the genders. It's just the way it is. Equal, as far as I'm concerned, would be equal status, equal concern. That I could see happening. I can't see equal compassion. I can't see equal empathy. I cannot see seeing the two genders or viewing them, at least in the social or informal sense, as being... I don't think the sentencing disparity is ever going to go completely away. We might be able to minimize it, but I don't think it's ever going to go away, just because of how we differ in our appearance and how we differ in our sexual selection criteria, how we differ in our reproductive strategies, all of those things. So, I mean, like, we're never going to be equal in the sense that we're the same or treated the same. There is something that we can do as far as being treated equitably, where maybe one gender has certain disadvantages and certain advantages, and the other has sort of the reverse of that. That I can see happening, and that being able to build a fair society out of what we can realistically do. But I can't see both genders being treated the same, particularly not socially. And as far as building an egalitarian society with only one gender doing it, I'm not sure. What can you repeat that part of the question, Rachel?
Sorry, mute button. What part of the question exactly? The
With only one side.
Okay. It says, can a truly gender egalitarian society be built completely and only by one gender, while the other gender only cares about positions of leadership and power? Basically, they compared it to apartheid in South Africa with the power differential.
Well, okay.
Between whites and blacks.
So basically what you're saying is that women are demanding an egalitarian society, and they're demanding that men build it for them. And that's not a traditional way of doing things at all. Women demanding things be done a certain way and men doing it. I seem to recall a friend of mine who was feminist, very adamantly feminist in some ways, telling me after, you know, I had to go and get some glucosamine and chondroitin to repair my shoulder and elbow from chipping through hard pan in my backyard to terrace my yard, I think probably 90 days in a row for several hours a day. She said, don't you realize you're supposed to just take a picture out of a magazine, hand it to your husband, and he's supposed to do it for you, right? He's supposed to make it look like that. And I think that in a lot of ways, what feminists want is that version of equality, that version of partnership where they say, I want society to look like this, men make it happen. And there can't be any kind of equality or equity to be found in that kind of arrangement. Men and women need to work as a team. They need to agree on a vision of what they want, and then they need to both contribute some effort and some work into doing it. So, like the whole he for she thing, it's absolutely ridiculous. The he for she thing, Emma Watson at the UN, that basically just says, men, here's what I want my life to look like, make it happen. How on earth is that a vision of equality? That's just a vision of male servitude and female entitlement. And I don't think it's even remotely possible to achieve any kind of egalitarianism, equality, or equity in any way, shape, or form if this is the way that we're going to approach it.
Sorry, mute button. I'm trying not to get as much feedback on my end because my computer is, the fan is loud. All right, let's see. Let's go to other questions here. Do you agree with the sentence, there is no seduction without some form of aggression? In the sense of attraction happens in sequence of a bold behavior and disregard of the reaction. Seeing feminists try to ban male audacity, and sometimes it's hard to know what is allowed or not when flirting. I think
There's one thing that I'm going to take issue with that. It's not about being bold and then having a disregard of the reaction. That's you never, ever, ever, and like I have been the aggressor or the initiator in some sexual relationships. I've taken the lead in some of those, mostly since I separated from my ex. But in some cases, even before I was married, you never disregard the reaction. You never just kind of just not consider it. You always have it in the back of your heck of your head that the resistance is token, right? That the resistance is just there for show. Or it's just there, and I've done this too myself, right? Oh, we shouldn't. Oh, I shouldn't. Or, you shouldn't. All of those things that you say because you know, you really want to, but, you know, you just don't want to just give in right that second. And it's one of those things that I think both men and women sometimes do. You should never, ever, ever completely disregard the reaction. You should never necessarily take it at face value or just as what the words mean outside of context, outside of body language, outside of what people's hands are doing, what their facial expressions are. But I do think that we are coming to a place, what feminists seem to want is that all human sexual interactions become completely clinical and completely sterile and almost written in legalese. And this is not how human sexuality works. It's not how it's ever worked. And I really, if you want to reduce the birth rate even more than it already is, you know, this is the way to go, because people are just not going to be hooking up. People are not going to be having sex. Not even husbands and wives under the criteria that feminists seem to want. So.
Sorry, my mute.
Sorry,
button.
My mute button.
It's
oh,
okay.
I'm getting a little bit of echo.
And Rachel, do you have the Hangout open or in the YouTube?
Oh, do I?
No, actually, the echo has stopped, so it might actually be Karen.
Yes. So, yes, I think. Yes, I think.
Totally not me. Don't blame me.
It's your damn fault.
Blaming.
Not rah. Okay. Well,
here's a lighter question. Sorry. Will you, Karen, ever read Shrek is Love, Shrek is Life in your Gilbert Godfrey voice?
Oh God. My daughter made me watch that. My daughter, my fucking innocent, wonderful, beautiful daughter made me watch that. She thought it was great. I can't say I won't ever read that in the Gilbert Gottfried voice. I can't promise I will, but I can't swear or vow that I will never do that. I might just, I guess it all depends. Shrek is love.
Shrek is love. Shrek is love.
Shrek is love. Shrek is love.
Shrek is something.
Yeah, there's
a
scene. And it's coming.
And it's coming.
Oh. That is like one of the creepiest things I have ever seen.
Is the echo?
No,
well, the echo is pretty creepy, but the Shrek thing, that was even more creepy. So.
Yes. I would agree.
Okay, you guys are the mic. So when you're asking a question, Karen, you're gonna have to be muted, and Rachel, when Karen's answering a question, you're gonna have to mute. Because it looks like we're having technical difficulties, which is why I stepped out of the shadows. Yes. But I also wanted to apologize to the listeners for the accidental hangout on the Honey Badger channel, which was entirely a miscommunication and between some parties, and we apologize for it. And there are some questions from that channel that I would like to bring up if Rachel is okay with that.
Sure.
Girl writes what, Karen? What do you know about the situation in Europe or Estonia? Go ahead, Karen.
Go ahead, Karen.
I know nothing about the situation in Estonia. As far as Europe goes, I know there's a lot of dissatisfaction with the European Union. I know that there's a lot of feminist legislation that has been pushed through in Spain and elsewhere. I think femicide is now a particular considered a particularly egregious crime in Spain. There's all kinds of craziness going on. There's proposals to the European Union to make it illegal, make it a criminal offense to criticize or ridicule feminism along with other ideologies, and it's a complete freaking mess. I was just actually watching a Sargon of Akkad video just today that had a bunch of people in the UK. They were talking about rape in the UK, and someone, I think it was James Dellingpole, maybe, at least it looked like him, who brought up that there is a disproportionate number of these offenses committed by Muslim immigrants, and there was an extreme amount of, you know, and even in the wake of the Rotherham issue, right, there was still an extreme amount of outrage from the audience that somebody would draw attention to the fact that 5.8% of the population is committing 28% of the rapes, that this should be considered something, a truth to be spoken, just offensive. It's offensive to even speak it, even though it's right there in black and white on paper, 5.8% of the population, 28% of the rapes. There's just a huge amount, the whole thing with offensive speech in the UK and limits on free speech. The young man who was arrested and jailed for calling a police officer's horse gay. Just all of these things that scare the ever-loving fuck out of me, because they are so, I mean, they seem so civilized, right? Of course we should put limits on what people should say, or people can say, right? Except for that's just the thin end of the wedge, right? That's the thin edge of the wedge that starts banning all kinds of speech, not just speech that's really egregious or really hateful. And so, I mean, like, I know that there's all kinds of bullshit going on in Europe. I'm not particularly well-informed on any any individual issue, but I do know that there's all kinds of bullshit that's been going on all through Europe, all across Europe, and that really there's I'm hoping a group of people who are getting sick of it. So
okay, well
thank you.
Oops.
I go.
I'll let you mute there.
All right, I'll mute. Oh my god. So you're so boss.
So this is from MetaSelf. Karen, why do you think, I think this is the JRE podcast hasn't contacted you back yet. Not quite sure.
I know what that is. It's the Joe Rogan experience.
Yeah. I think probably the reason why they haven't gotten back to me, like, Joe Rogan has he's tweeted me a couple of times, sort of included me on tweets. People tweeted at him, why haven't you had Karen on yet? And then he included me on a tweet back that, you know, that said, hey, Karen, you know, we'd love to have her on. We're working out the details, you know, and then, hey, message me. Follow me and then message me. And, you know, I'm just like, you have my email. When they initially contacted me, it was through two of my emails and my YouTube and my Twitter. And all within the space of 5 minutes, I'm assuming, to make sure that the message got through and that I would see it and notice it. And there was all kinds of hype, and they sort of publicized it, and they came out and said, they went on Reddit and said, oh yeah, we're going to do an Ask Me Anything on the Joe Rogan Experience subreddit, and we're going to, you know, yes, we're going to have her on the podcast, but Joe's on tour right now, and so we just have to work out the details. And then, like, 6 months later, I still haven't heard back. And, you know, I don't know. Maybe he thinks I'm too controversial. Maybe he thinks I'm full of shit. You know, like, I don't really know. I don't want to think that he just doesn't want to touch it. But on the other hand, maybe he just doesn't want to touch it. And if that's the case, that's fine. It annoyed me that he told his fans that he was working out the details when I hadn't been in contact with them for like over 6 months. But yeah, I don't know that it's going to happen. So, and I'm not sure why. They haven't given me any indication as to why, so.
All right. I'm going to wait for, yeah, thank you, Karen. What do you like most about yourself? This is from M. Not Sure If Serious. To Karen, what do you like most about yourself, and what do you like least, and why? Cat smiley face.
What do I like most about myself? This is going to seem really, I guess maybe what I like most about myself is that, like, and it hasn't always been like this, right? I mean, like, I was your, you know, your typical person for the longest time, but what I like most about myself is just not caring about what other people think of me. Like, I don't care if I lose my job. I don't care. Like, I know I can get another one. I don't care if somebody doesn't like me. There are plenty of people who do like me. I don't care if lots of people hate me, because I know lots of people like me. And I don't, even if everybody hated me, I would like myself, because I just don't care. There's a certain kind of, a certainty in yourself. I wouldn't even call it confidence, because I still do get nervous in certain situations, but just sort of a, I guess, sort of a, and I have this sort of overarching feeling that everything's going to be okay, right? Like that things, at least for me, in my life, you know, my plumbing blows up, or my, you know, my furnace dies, or what, like, everything's gonna it's all gonna work out. It's gonna work itself out one way or another. I'm gonna manage to deal with it, right? And I, maybe that comes from just a history over the last probably 10 or 15 years of dealing with crises and managing to come out on top of them. So I really like that about myself, that just sort of the ability to remain calm in a crisis and just know that whatever happens, it'll be the best of what could possibly happen, right? Like that, as long as I'm paying attention to it, even if it's not what I want, it's the best of what could possibly happen. So, there's sort of that I like about myself. It really makes me able to, I guess, say whatever the hell I want and not really care a whole lot about the consequences. I don't generally say things that I don't mean, at least not in a sincere way. I say a lot of things I don't mean in an insincere way. Like, I threaten to beat my kids all the time, but I don't do it. But yeah, no, I feel like I can go out in the world and do what I do, and there's not going to be some big disaster. Like, I don't have anxieties about anything like that. And what I like least about myself? God. I don't know if there's anything I don't like about myself. I love everything about myself. I'm smart, and I'm wonderful, and people, gosh darn it, people like me. I guess maybe I don't pay enough attention to my friendships. I don't nurture them enough. I sort of, and this has been something that has always been with me. Even in middle school and high school, I don't know whether I ever made a single phone call. People always called me, I was never wanting for places to go and people to hang out with, but I never, ever called anyone. I never really took the initiative to maintain a friendship, and I tend to not miss friendships when they sort of fade on their own. Sometimes that bothers me because, you know, there are some people that I know from 5-10 years ago or whatever that I would really like to talk to and spend time with, but it's just been so long since I've never reached out to them, right? You know, it was just sort of I worked with them, I saw them every day, you know, type thing, and so it was an effortless thing. And when it comes to putting effort into maintaining friendships outside a very small circle of people that I really care about, I don't have the energy, or maybe I just don't think to put in the energy to maintain those. And I think that's something that I could really benefit from doing, rather than just leaving as it is. So I guess maybe those are the two things that I hope that answers your question.
Hi, Karen.
Mm-hmm.
Mute.
All mute. Oh my God, you're so pushy.
Blue Raven asks, "Hi, Karen. Do you think you can help change the overall toxic feminist community, or help influence people to fight back against the double standards that modern day feminism holds?"
I don't think that anything can really help the toxic feminist community. I think, or the toxicism that is. I think that feminism, at least as I define it, which is the set of theories, the set of hypotheses, and sort of ideological constructs, I don't think that there's any saving that, or making it less toxic. I think its very axioms are toxic. Its axioms are its conclusions. You know, you start with the axiom and you conclude with the axiom, which is that men are oppressors and women are oppressed. So, like, I don't think there's any salvaging that, and I don't think there's any salvaging people who have wholeheartedly swallowed that ideology, at least not in the sense that the ideology can be saved. I think individuals can recover from that or be deprogrammed or come out of that, but I don't think that the ideology itself has anything useful or anything meaningful or just to say about the world. Fighting back, getting people to fight back against the double standards. I think that we're seeing that now. We're seeing that more and more. It's Glenn Poole. He writes for, I think, the Telegraph or is it the Daily Mail? But he writes semi-regular columns for them, and he's, I mean, I wouldn't necessarily call him, you know, on par with the sort of the A Voice for Men style rhetoric, but he's very definitely extremely critical of feminism. Even Ali Fogg has managed to stay on free thought blogs while being critical of misandry within the culture, and somewhat critical of feminism for buying into that or perpetuating it. There's more and more people who are acknowledging that there is a double standard, and who are acknowledging that certain things deserve attention. And I think that that's definitely something we can do. As far as rescuing feminism from itself, I don't think that that's possible. It's toxic. I mean, like the foundation that it's based on is a toxic and hateful foundation. So, yeah, individual feminists, sure, there's hope, but feminism itself, no.
I'll give you a moment. Mute. Ben Misera asks, and I probably mispronounced that, sorry, Ben. Hi, Karen. Do you think that ordinary gay men are beginning to realize how they're used by feminists as, amongst other things, human shields and emotional tampons? End question. Take it away, Karen.
I think some gay men have always realized that. I definitely think that there are some gay men who have always been wise to that strategy on the part of feminist women. I'm not 100% sure that because gay, lesbian, trans, bisexual, queer questioning, all of those are sort of lumped into one big category, and they're assumed to be one big community, and they're really not. There's as sort of a peripheral member of that community, I definitely know how some of its members feel ill-used by sort of the wider community. I don't think that their interests are all identical. But I think that because they've sort of been lumped into this sort of quilt bag, a lot of them cling to the allegiances, and because feminism and lesbianism are there's a relationship there going back to the second wave, to lesbian separatism, that it's almost like assumed that the LGBTQ community is under the rubric of feminist ideology and feminist advocacy. And I think that, you know, more and more gay men are waking up to the fact that these women don't necessarily have their interests at heart. But I mean, I think that when you look at the people who were screaming at us in Toronto during that rally that I attended at Miles Groth's talk just the day after, it was mostly queer men and gay men who were yelling through the bullhorn. So I think that there's definitely there's a schism in the gay male community that definitely some of them are wise to what sort of the co-opting nature of feminism to just bring all of this, everything it can, it will try and pull it into its gullet and use it as ballast to get what it wants for women. But as there's still going to be a strong sector, I guess, of gay men who toe the line, the feminist line, and believe that feminism is in their best interest. So I it's improving as far as I can see, but it's nowhere near the point where I think that gay men en masse are realizing that feminism is not for them. So.
Rachel. Okay. I have several more. A ton of these. All right. Are you of the persuasion that MGTOWs cannot be married?
Um, I would actually say that it may be the case that MGTOWs can't get married. I think that someone who is already married can decide to become MGTOW and can find a way to coexist with his wife within that paradigm. But I think that being a MGTOW first and then deciding to get married is it's a little iffy. I mean, like, I suppose it's possible, but I don't think it's plausible. I guess, like, I don't really want to get into this whole debate because right now it's fraught with all kinds of difficulty and infighting and all of that. I don't think marriage... I don't think that a lifelong commitment, freely chosen on one's own terms, so, you know, a jump over the broomstick type of marriage, I don't think that that's incompatible with MGTOW. I think that signing a blank piece of paper where the terms are decided at the point of its dissolution, that might be something completely different, so maybe not quite as conducive to or in line with MGTOW values. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I asked a question. Well, it was something posed, so I... All right, here we are. We have a 40% mandate in companies that females should be on the board of the company. Do you think that's fair towards society, or are politicians just wanting to fix a problem where there isn't one?
Well, I think you know the answer that what I'm going to say. If you've seen anything that I've done, it's absolutely a ridiculous thing. The only evidence that we have to date, as far as mandated quotas, you know, and this is not companies that just happen to have a high ratio of women to men, just because those companies seem to do just fine, but the companies that I forget what country it was it Norway or was it Sweden, some of the they gave these companies 2 years, right, to do this quota, and the ones that complied immediately, after the 2 years, they were doing more poorly. They were doing worse than companies who had not complied yet, right? And so, I mean, basically, it's not a matter of necessarily men and or women being better at the job. It's a matter of, in order to fill the quota, you end up having to go into a pool of people who are less qualified and promote them above the level that they're really ready to be promoted. So, I mean, there's really nothing, a lot of people say, a lot of feminists like to say that it's the testosterone-filled boardroom that leads to these bubbles and bursts, right, and all of these crashes and all of this other stuff, right? And there is something to be said for risk-taking behavior, which is linked to testosterone, you know, that a very, very sort of an environment in which risk-taking, just reckless behavior is encouraged, you know, that this is not good business. But at the same time, testosterone's also been linked to honesty. It's been linked to the reduction in the telling of self-serving lies. It's been linked to fair bargaining behavior. It's been linked to all kinds of other things that are conducive to good business, that are linked to good business practices. And I don't think that... you know, men and women may have, in aggregate, they may have different approaches, but when you get up to that high level of achievement and ambition and being willing to put in the 70-hour weeks. Most of the women at that level, these would be women who, you know, if they get there on their own, like Margaret Thatcher did, they're going to be more mannish in their traits, in their behaviors, in their decisions, than womanish. So there's really nothing, nothing to really say that having the average woman or a woman with average or typical female traits at that level is going to make things better, because the women that typically even get to that level don't have typical female traits. So, I mean, there's no evidence that it improves anything. There's no evidence that it benefits businesses. There's no evidence that it makes them more competitive. There's no evidence that it makes them more stable. There's just no evidence at all that it benefits anybody except for the individual women involved and the feminist lobbyists who are pushing for these changes. And what does happen is that you end up with people who are not qualified or not qualified yet. They haven't got the experience yet, being promoted into positions they're not ready for. And that's not good either, right? So, I mean, it's a completely ridiculous thing. And it's also completely ridiculous to think that a man in the boardroom is not going to be able to market a product to women. Right, I mean, it's ridiculous.
Mute, Karen.
I mute.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see here. We've got. All right. And here's the second. I think this is by the same person. Oh, and another one. What do you think about feminists attacking video games that has led into the Gamergate movement, where Anita Sarkeesian, Brianna Wu, and Zoe Quinn use feminism to justify their actions, like blaming male toxicity for the problems in society? Can you hear me?
Okay, so what do I think of Gamergate?
I think it's more about feminists attacking video games. And having their corruption justified because they're feminists.
Oh well, that entire thing. I've never seen a more manufactured outrage than the sort of the outrage that Anita Sarkeesian has over the portrayal of women in video games. If I have seen one that's, you know, just as phony and manipulative and ridiculous, it's the claim that Gamergate is about misogyny. And I'm not going to say that Gamergate is only about ethics in journalism, because it's not. A lot of Gamergaters may only be in it for that reason. There may be many Gamergaters who are only in it over the ethics argument, but I think the primary reason is that gamers don't want their games politicized, and they certainly don't want them politicized by feminism. They don't want to be preached to in their video games. You know, if they did, they'd go, you know, to Bible school or something. They'd sing Kumbaya and play, you know, wholesome, you know, board games, you know, with their families. They don't want that in their form of entertainment. And this is the fact that it's their entertainment, it's their hobby, not their job, is probably the only thing that's keeping feminism sort of on the fringes of it. If the average gamer was worried about losing his job for objecting to this, or for writing an angry letter to Intel, or for, you know, making a comment on an article or whatever, speaking his mind, if the average gamer was worried because his entire career was riding on it rather than his hobby, you know, you can't be fired from a hobby, then all of, you know, there would have been, the takeover would have already happened, right? The social justice, feminist, politically correct takeover would have already happened in gaming. But it is such a, it's still enough of a subculture. It's still enough of sort of an alternative culture. It's not completely mainstream like movies. And on top of that, it's completely consumer driven, right? So, because the people who are objecting to this are gamers, and they are the ones who butters everyone's bread in the industry, right? They are the ones with power, as long as they stick together and as long as they don't pander or you know, open the door that crack and let people get their foot in. But as far as the claims that it's misogyny, that's absolutely ridiculous. It's a deflection. It's a distraction. It's like Pinky in the Brain. You know, when Pinky goes, look, a diversion, right? That's all it is, right? Oh, look, misogyny, right? Sick 'em, boys. That's all it is. And so, I mean, it's the entire thing is ridiculous.
Sorry, mute button. All right, here we are. Can I borrow a dollar?
Never. Never. I gave my last $7 to my son when I sent him out into the blizzard to go to work. Yeah, to take the bus to work. And then he's going to come home. He's going to be all covered because he's a dishwasher at a restaurant. He's going to be all covered. His pants are going to be like completely soaking wet. When he gets home, they'll be frozen on him. And that $3.50, that second $3.50 that I gave him, that I didn't give you a dollar of, that will have got him home on the bus. So there you go. That's why I can't give you a dollar.
Aww.
Yeah.
A question. From now on, each time you upload a video to YouTube, will you also upload it to the Vimeo Manosphere group? That's my question. The answer to it is
Waffle.
Will I upload it to the Vimeo Manosphere group? Oh. That seems like a lot of work. I have to learn a whole nother website. You know, I suppose I could. I'm wondering if. How about this? How about I try it out, and if it happens to work okay, I'll keep doing it. If it's easy, if it's not like a huge ginormous pain or very difficult for my computer to do or something. And if not, I will put out a call and let you guys know that you can download all my videos and upload them to the Vimeo group. How's that?
Mm-hmm. All right. Do you think there's a patriarchy in a sense of a destructive part that worships control, competition and possession within which women and their way of thinking and connection to the immediate are actually subject of contempt in a way that female perception isn't as likely to be victim of an abstract thinking that excludes feeling and compassion rather than abstract ideas of optimization and very similar things? I'm not really sure what they're asking here. That's kind of...
Is there text of that question?
Yeah, because I think
because that's very convoluted.
Yes, it is.
Yes,
it
I should have. I should.
If you could paste it into the chat window, that would be lovely. Okay.
While you're doing that.
Do I think there is a patriarchy in a sense of a destructive part that worships control, competition, and possession within which women and their way of thinking in connection to the immediate are actually subject of contempt? No. Absolutely not. I suppose there is a patriarchy in the sense that things like competition and possession are considered male, and things like connection to the immediate, which would I assume be emotionality and sort of sentimentality, are considered female. I do not think that those female things are held in contempt. And I don't think that those male things are held to be above them. I think that those male things are held to be male, and those female things are held to be female. So they are the male things are admirable in the male, and the female things are admirable in the female. And this is one of the things, is that feminism seems to see that, say, things like competition is admired in men and not so admired in women. And they see that as a denigration of femaleness, right? That female traits aren't admired, right? But then they turn it around and they say, well, these female traits that are admired in females, which are their emotionality, their sentimentality, their nurturingness. You have to be sentimental and emotional to be nurturing and to be to sort of be cuddly and friendly and wonderful and warm and all of those things, right? That those things, they say, because those things aren't valued in men, they're not valued at all. When, you know, and therefore, when men do those things and they're, you know, they're being told, don't be like a woman, right, that's a denigration of femaleness as well. So when women aren't like men, that's a denigration of femaleness, right? And so when women are like women, that's a denigration of femaleness. And when men are like men, that's also a denigration of femaleness. They want it all to flow one way. It's all a denigration of femininity. When in reality, the traits that they say have been held in contempt, and they are sometimes held in contempt in the sense that when a woman is extremely irrational, like if she has borderline personality disorder, you know, which women are more likely to have than men. I think it's 3/4 of sufferers are women. That this is a denigration of the female because people take issue with it. There are aspects of masculinity when they're taken to an extreme that are extremely toxic, that are extremely harmful to society or extremely harmful to individual men and to women and to children. Right? When you take them to the nth degree, of course there are, and of course this is the way with women as well, right? So but they don't want to admit that there's such a thing as toxic femininity. They want to say that it's society just sees all the feminine as toxic, all of it, right? That's not the case. I think that society has always valued feminine traits in women, and it has been more willing to value masculine traits in women than it has been to value non-masculine traits in men. And this is the thing. It's not even that these are feminine traits in men. It's just they're not living up to the standard of masculinity. You know, it just, I feel like they want to have it both ways, right? If you say, I admire a man for being a man, you are privileging masculinity and denigrating femininity. And if you say you admire a woman for being a woman, you are privileging masculinity and limiting and denigrating femininity. You're subordinating it, and it's ridiculous. Okay, let me just see if there's another like the other part. Female perception isn't as likely to be victim of an abstracted thinking that excludes feeling and compassion. Female perception. Okay, I don't know what you mean by victim here. Female perception isn't as likely to be a victim of abstracted thinking that excludes feeling and compassion rather than abstract areas of optimization and very similar things. I don't think that there's anything to be a victim of there. I can't say that a person can be a victim of being of logic any more than I can say that they're a victim of emotion. They're two different ways of perceiving the world through emotion or through logic and reason. I can't really describe either way as necessarily being preferable. So,
all right. Nefnor like sent me a message. He says, "Ask Karen, will she ever finish renovating her house enough to have Nick and Neff over to stare down her dog again?"
Well, Nick was just over the other day. Didn't you see the video? His dreads were growing in quite well. He let me touch them and everything. You're definitely welcome over any time, Nefnor. My place right now, my front yard is knee-deep in snow, and my living room is knee-deep in dog hair. But if you're willing to tolerate that, that's fine. You might want to come over soon, because my boyfriend has vowed to chop up my dog soon and stew her. So, there you go. But he's
no,
promised.
No.
Oh, yes, he's promised. Probably going to cut her up and eat her soon. So, yeah. He's one of those really, really awful, horrible dog eating, not even kitten eating. He's too manly for that. He doesn't eat kittens. He eats dogs, full grown ones.
Okay. All right. This question right here is already asked. It was from the other thing. It was about the Joe Rogan experience or whatever. Okay. Have you given any thought to making a pinup calendar with the other honey badgers in the old World War II propaganda style? If it could have factoids about the MRM and related subjects and pre-filled in dates of importance for the MRM. We are fighting a war and all, and it could create some revenue for the war chests. I mean, chest. What?
I think he meant breast. Or teats, maybe. I suppose I would be willing to do that. I don't have any problem with that kind of thing, and I don't know who would want to look at my 44-year-old ass, but I suppose if somebody actually wants to do that, then more power to them, and if it brings in money, then that would be fine. I would have to get the permission of the other honey badgers, though, to participate, so that requires more than my answer.
Oh, God. I would do drawings.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're that interested, I did do a drawing of Karen riding a bomb. Of course, it's quite tongue-in-cheek, but it's still somewhat sexy, and we're putting it on a t-shirt. And if you're interested, you can just check it out on the show page. The link is on the actual ad to the show. And if you like that kind of thing, you can purchase the t-shirt of that. And I mean, it sounds like a lot of work. I think I understand what they're asking, like a 50s style pinup artwork, right? Not actual pictures. I mean, because I really don't think actual pictures.
Was it 40s style?
Oh, 40s. Okay, well, 40s style pinup artwork. Yeah, that's something that's cool because it's fun. I can create something, but taking a picture? No, absolutely not. No freaking way.
It's always got to look like the woman always has to look slightly surprised, as if she's saying, "Gee whiz, mister!"
Yeah. No,
I would never look surprised. I'd be like, "Oh yeah, bring it. Bring that camera over here." So, I don't know. Maybe that's just me.
Well, I'm
shameless. I came out and admitted it earlier. You know, essentially, in so many words, I'm shameless. So, there you go.
So you would pose.
Oh yeah, I totally would.
I would
even pose in the All Together.
I would be very clever.
Running away.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I guess maybe you hit a certain age and you just are no longer that self-conscious. I was much more self-conscious. I was much more aware of the flaws of my body when I was in my 20s. Much more sort of anxious about them or thinking about them than I am now. Now I don't really care. I feel like I look okay, and, you know, for 44, I look pretty okay, and I don't really worry about that kind of stuff anymore. So, yeah, maybe it's age.
Yeah, who knows? Well, you know, that could be interesting. Okay, see here. My questions are, but all related, with all the issues that men face, how do we counter them? And will radical feminism, third wave, ever die out? Or do you think this is just the beginning of the end? And finally, does this look infected to you? There's a picture here of what appears to be a woman.
Oh, dear. Okay, I'm looking at the picture. Oh my goodness. What did you do to yourself?
That's horrible.
Yes, that looks infected. I would suggest that you seek treatment immediately. And just because you're going to end up with gangrene or losing the end of your finger. If you can't afford medical treatment, I suggest you take a razor blade, sanitize it with a lighter, slice into that as deep as you can go, squeeze everything out of it that you can, and then slather it with polysporin, alcohol, anything, vodka, whatever you got on hand. Because that looks really not good. I actually here. Let me show you. I'm gonna show you. Even though I'm in my not for public consumption place. I'm in my bedroom, locked in here because my kids are home. I'm gonna turn on my camera and I'm gonna show you my beautiful, beautiful. I don't know if you can see it on this here. That got into the subcutaneous fat. And, yeah, it wasn't even infected. It was a bite from some kind of insect that had necrotizing venom, and it melted away a whole bunch of my skin and fat and all of that, and it was lovely, and it could have been a really bad thing. So you need to you need to look after your finger, please. And I forget what the question was before that.
Oh God!
Because yeah, that finger just really
yeah. The question was will radical feminism ever die out? Or do you think this is the beginning of the end?
Okay. Before we continue, Do you have headphones?
I don't have headphones.
Can you turn your volume on your speaker?
I've turned it down a little
bit.
Well, it reduces.
Okay, so this is something that we're just going to have to bring up.
Okay, you guys mute.
Do you need
headphones?
No, I can get headphones. It's just hit or miss whether they're gonna work with my computer. So.
Okay, so you don't know if you have to work with your computer.
Yeah, no, I have a MacBook Air, and it's one of those kind of finicky ones. You can't hook up an external camera to it. You can't hook up an external mic to it. Headphones may or may not work. So, yeah, I just tend to avoid them. And I haven't really had any problems with them until... I have not used headphones for the last God knows how many radio shows and interviews. Have not bothered to use them. So I'm not sure what the issue is with this. But as far as... will radical feminism ever die out? Probably not. I think that radical feminism is a function of female dysfunction and female damage, and as long as there are women who are damaged or women who are disordered or women who are dysfunctional, there will always be a radical feminism. I think that the best we can do is probably to disabuse the public that there's any sense in what they say. So, yeah, I think that there will always, I would love for them to be pushed to the margins in the same way as a cult or an extremist religion like the Westboro Baptist Church. I would really love to see that happen. But I don't think they're ever going to go away. So, yeah.
Kind of brings up, it kind of reminds me of, there's that cartoon that's going around the internet of, like, based mom as an actual mom and, like, third wave feminism as, like, a little screaming child. And she's like, come on, I've got you some juicy. And it says, like, truth and logic on the bottle. And she's like, I think it's time for you to take a nap. And she's like, but I'm oppressed. The little girl. And she's like, oh, come on, get a nap.
Well, yeah, I mean, that really is, I mean, like, I wouldn't go so far as, you know, because she and I, Christina Hoff Summers and I, disagree on some things. I mean, she saw many admirable, I think maybe she sees second wave and first wave feminism through sort of rose-colored glasses, where she sees only the good things that it did and that it wanted to achieve, and I suppose if there's some merit in that first and second wave feminism did some good things and achieved some good things, there just, as far as I can tell, there was always an underlying injustice underneath each one of them. So she and I disagree on those things, but I mean, as far as people who call themselves feminists, she's one of the sanest people I can think of. She's one of the most the most rational people I can think of, and she certainly has not been. She hasn't been reluctant to criticize modern feminism in any way, shape, or form, and she's been very, very good about championing masculinity, not enforcement of masculinity, but permission for masculinity, which I think is really what we need to have, not necessarily enforcement of it, but permission for it. So there you go.
All right, well, there's other questions here. And seriously, okay, go get that checked out. Because, you know, even a minor staph infection can get really bad. So, okay, anyway, this is a weird question. Do you think it is possible to articulate complex multi-syllabic speech whilst implementing polyphonic overtone singing?
No.
Will you be in Calgary sometime soon?
I think the earliest I'll be there is, I think, in April of next year. So I think I'm planning on heading down there in April, I believe. Who knows? I could be there earlier, but I have no plans to be, so...
I can. We have some plans in the works to attend a convention in Calgary. The Canadian and Comics and Entertainment Expo, and it's going to be. I have to check my calendar. I didn't have this prepared because I didn't expect that question, but it's going to be the. The 17th to the 19th, I believe. I would double check that because I'm not entirely sure that is completely correct. But it is the Calgary Comics and Entertainment Expo, and we're gonna have some fun and try to make some inroads into geek culture, because this is where the battleground seems to be drawn. So there you go. If you're in the Calgary and surrounding area, then consider coming down and meeting up with us. And I will end my spiel there, because this isn't really Ask Typhon shit. It's Ask Karen shit. And yeah, okay, go ahead, Rachel. Take it away.
All right, there's another question here. Are you really a waitress?
Yeah, I am really a waitress. I worked last night. It was initially a table. It was going to be four adults and two children. The children were under six. It turned into a table of five adults and three children, all under six. And I'm not going to say what ethnicity they were, but it's sort of a cultural thing that they don't really have the restaurant experience 100% down, at least not the North American restaurant experience. And one of their kids, he was about three or four, and he threw his 12-inch Spider-Man action figure up into the air and almost beamed another customer in the head with it while he was eating his dinner. And they just would not control their children, and oh my god, and just what a freaking nightmare. And five birthday candles I had to light. Oh, it was a nightmare. It was and the hostess did not move the circle. She has her little circle saying who's gonna be seated next. And so then she would seat me, but she wouldn't move the circle. And then she'd forget to move it, and then so the next table would come in, and she'd be like, "Oh, it's Karen's turn," right? And she'd seat me again, and so I'd like three tables all at once. Oh my god! Like what the? And you're seating them 3 feet away from this table with these children, who are like causing a freaking public health hazard. And yeah, like, and why would you seat them like 40 feet away on the other side of the restaurant where they'll actually be able to eat in peace? Why would you seat them right next to this table with these horrible children. So yes, I am actually a waitress. Really and for true.
All right, let's see here. This is, oh gosh, it says, if you were given the ability to instantly change the mind of any single feminist, which one would it be? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Any single feminist.
Yes.
Which one would it be? I wouldn't say Anita Sarkeesian because I don't think she's sincere. Jessica Valenti. Or Amanda Marcotte. One of those two. Because I think that they actually are sincere. I think that they actually believe what they say. So, I mean, like, if I changed Anita Sarkeesian's mind, I don't think she would change her shtick. It's proved too profitable for her. And it really seems to be the only thing that has been profitable for her. But Amanda Marcotte and Jessica Valenti both have a fairly wide reach, and I would see one of those two as being worth deprogramming, I guess.
Mm-hmm. All right. Next one is, if this were to be, say, a comic book or a cartoon in which you were the hero, which feminist would be your antagonist or villain?
All of them. Wave after wave. Wave after wave of feminists with hair dyed, unnatural colors, nose piercings, eyebrow piercings, those plugs that they put in their earlobes to stretch them out. I can't think of which one of the, like, it's the ideology that I oppose. It's not necessarily anybody personally. You know, like, I really have some animosity towards certain feminists, but it's not really them. It's just what they do and what they say and what they believe or claim to believe that I have a problem with. So I don't know that I would really choose any feminist.
Like you said, though, if you think about it, though, you are kind of like Batman in a way, because all of Batman's villains are basically basically just insane, and they have crazy hair color and weird makeup and all kinds of stuff. I don't know.
There you go. They're all the Joker. They're all the Joker in drag.
Oh, God.
So. Well, the Joker has a sense of ethics. He has a code of ethics. Even if it doesn't necessarily fit with everybody else's code, at least he sort of, you know, has a standard that he lives up to and is relatively consistent with, so.
Mm-hmm. Can you please visit Sweden? We need you, Karen.
Never. I will never go there. Maybe one day. It's just across the strait from Denmark, and I may be going and visiting family in Denmark at some point. So you never know. I don't really have the income for transcontinental travel. So. But you never know. In the future sometime. Maybe I will.
All right. Let's see here. Two questions. One, what is the best response to the many times debunked go-to points for feminists such as wage gap, etc.? And number two, feminism in its original intent and most uncorrupt sense obviously has its place in the world with equality. What are the pressing issues which feminism should be looking at in the world?
Okay, well, the go-to response for anything like the wage gap is just going to be just the word bullshit and then a link to something that debunks the wage gap. That's really the only effort that you need to put into it. I suppose there are other things like rape culture that require a little bit of explanation or a little bit of sort of exposition. But most of their talking points, they really don't require a whole lot of effort to sort of come back or counter argue. What was the second half of the question?
It says feminism in its original intent. Oh, I can hear myself. Mute.
Sorry. Okay.
Feminism, in its original intent and most uncorrupt sense, obviously has its place in the world. That's an assumption. With equality, what are the pressing issues which feminism should be looking at in the world?
Okay. Here we come down to definitions again, right? Because if you define feminism as just the advocacy for, you're right? But if you define feminism the way I do, which is the set of theories and hypotheses and ideologies and doctrines and orthodoxies that are taught in women's studies, the sort of the oppression model, then I don't think feminism does have a place in the world in any kind of model of equality or equity. And I don't think that there are any feminist issues because I don't think that there are any issues out there that are based on any women's issues that are based on a hatred of women or a contempt for women, or a fear of women. Not really. I think in any society that we claim is super misogynist, like the common claim is that Islamic societies are super misogynist, I think that you'll find that however harshly they treat their women, they treat their men worse, more harshly. However much they punish their women for going outside the boundaries of what's permissible, they punish their men worse. For all of the demands that they place on women, they place equal or greater demands on men. So I really don't know that there are any feminist issues out there even in the most harsh societies, even in the most, I guess you would call brutal or even primitive societies. I don't think that there are any issues that feminism could solve, because feminism will look at it as a function of male oppressors and female oppressed, and this is not a helpful lens. It's not a lens that that can really ameliorate those problems, the problems that women have in those societies. Because anything that feminism does is going to abandon the men. It's either going to penalize the men, punish the men, condemn the men, or abandon the men. Women need their men, and I've even heard there were women in Afghanistan who were complaining that NGOs in their country only help women, and they're like, well, what are we supposed to do if all our men are dead, right? Like, sure, you're saving us, but, you know, like, I'm here, I have, like, 6 children. What am I supposed to do if you won't help my men? And this is what feminism does, is it ignores the plight of the average male, the typical male. It looks only at the men who are at the very apex of society, who are making the decisions. It says that all men are like that, that men are a collective, and the collective should be judged by the top tier of its members, the ones who are most able to act on society and others, and thus all men should be judged, and therefore no men deserve compassion, and therefore no men deserve help, and therefore all of our efforts will be put into helping women. And I don't even know that women want that. The lens that feminism looks through is not going to fix these problems. Not for men, not for women. So, I mean, you look at it and you, Gloria Steinem did an interview a few years ago. And the interviewer asked her, what about women now? You know, it seems like feminism is a louder voice than ever, and you know, it's almost like they think that women are more oppressed than ever. And she said, well, they are. Okay, and what was her reasoning behind her assertion that women are more oppressed than they were in the 1950s was the very things that feminists demanded in the 1960s and the 1970s. Equality in education, equality in the workplace, you know, equal opportunities for careers, all of those things, right? All of those things meant that women now have a greater burden and they are therefore more oppressed than ever. You know, like things like no-fault divorce, you know, single motherhood, all of these. So all of these things that feminism pushed for, right? Female autonomy, female liberation from men, you know, like you don't have to rely on a man, all of these things, right? These are now the reasons why women are more oppressed than they were in the 1950s. And, you know, so, and her answer to that, her solution for that is more feminism. And I'm just like, this is what happens when you take this extreme one-sided approach where you assume that one party or one group has been wronged and the other is the one who wronged them, and then you try to sort of ameliorate it based on that, and so you give the party that you feel has been wronged or deprived or limited or restricted, you give them all the freedoms, right? But then comes all of the responsibilities, and whether you want them or not, right? Because when you have the freedom to divorce in a no-fault divorce, you do end up with more responsibility than you had when you were married, because even if you're getting child support and alimony, you still have, if you got custody of the kids, you still have custody and responsibility for the day-to-day well-being of those kids and all of these things, and still having to have a job and all of these things, right? And she's saying that means women are more oppressed than ever, right? Like, how is feminism going to solve any of this bullshit, right? I mean, all it has done is make people miserable. You look at the paradox of the decline of female happiness. Female happiness was always, since we started measuring it, was always, women's satisfaction with their lives was always higher than men's up until the 1970s. And then it started to go down. And then it crossed men's. And both of them are declining, but women's have been declining at a much steeper rate, and they are less happy than men are now for the first time since we started measuring it. I mean, there's no solutions in feminism. There's no solutions within the feminist lens. There is only blame and punishment. That's all there is.
I'd like to go to some chats or some questions from the patron chat. Evildoer asks, I'd love to ask Karen her opinion on why she thinks radical feminism and victim culture has exploded in the last year or two. It's almost as if an invisible oppression 9/11 went off somewhere and we are feeling the effects. But what caused it?
I'm starting to think that it's all just doubling down. That people are starting to call them on their bullshit, and people really are. And it's not just right-wingers. And even when it's right-wingers, it's often right-wingers who are sort of just like the pro-freedom of speech, pro-freedom of choice kind of Wild Rose Party right-wingers, right? So if you want to be fundamentally religious, go ahead. If you want to be an atheist, pro-abortionist, go ahead, right? That you know, and you should be able to say what you like and not be silenced. I mean, there's a lot of those types of people who lean toward the right, and at least here in Alberta where I am. And basically, I think so many people are calling them on their bluff that they really all they figure that they like all they can do is kind of screech louder. That they there's an interesting, I wrote a blog post about it the other day. There was a paper written on it called "When in Doubt, Shout," and it was based on the tendency for people who were deeply religious, if they were exposed to evidence that their religion was bunk, they would proselytize more. They would go even further to try to sway people to their beliefs. They would. There was an issue with one cult that they believed that a meteor was going to hit the earth or something like that. It would be the end of the world, and they all sold all of their homes and liquidated all of their funds and poured it all into this one endeavor of waiting for the spaceship or something like that to come and get them or save them or whatever. And then the meteor didn't hit the earth, or the aliens didn't come, or whatever it was. And their excuse was, their reasoning after the fact, when their prediction, their promise, the what was going to happen didn't happen, was that their faith had prevented it from happening, and therefore they were stronger in their faith because of that, and so they went on to more actively and aggressively recruit new members. And so, I mean, like, this seems to be, I think, what is going on. They have much less ground to stand on, but they are clinging to it sort of by the atoms on the tips of their fingernails, and they will not let it go, and they will scream the entire way down. This is really what I think, and maybe what I hope, that this latest outburst of the last 2 years is because so many men's issues are actually, they're coming to light in, at least in a way, maybe not even in the mainstream, but in a very visible way on the internet. So you go onto any article, a feminist article or whatever, and you'll find dissent. You'll find people posting evidence. You'll find people posting counter-arguments. You'll find people arguing against it, right? And it may even be the same 5,000 or 10,000 or 100,000 people doing it over and over again, but it's very visible. And I think that just the existence of an opposition that is not not actively and solidly grounded in the "we want women barefoot pregnant in the kitchen," that is not Rush Limbaugh, that is maybe even pro-choice, that is all of these sort of progressive, tolerant, I got nothing against gays kind of mindset, but I oppose feminism. All of those people speaking out, even if they aren't a huge portion of the population, because they speak out so strongly and they're so visible to these feminists, I think that they are feeling they're retreating to their motte, and I don't know whether their Bailey is ever going to be available to them again. They are not going to be able to sort of go into that space where they can operate in a way where they are seen as the ultimate authority and nobody's going to argue with them. And this is really what I think it is. And this is really, and the understanding that they really don't have anything to complain about, makes them just want to amplify their complaints and sort of make them mountains out of microaggressions and all of these things, right? That they are clinging to their belief and they won't let it go, and they, the very fact that people are challenging them makes them hold on to it harder and yell louder. So I think that that's probably what that is about. At least I hope that that's what that is about.
Okay. Another question from the patron chat. This is from Sai. Karen, do you have a web page or repository with all your sources you used in your videos? It's difficult to search through your videos to find the sources, and some of them don't have any.
Oh, dear. I don't actually have a repository. I thought about doing that about a year ago, and then I just kind of, I got absorbed in something else, house renovations or my boyfriend's diagnosis or something like that. I probably will at some point post a whole bunch of links to a whole bunch of different stuff. One of the things that I've been doing over the last couple of days is I've been sort of gobbling up pretty much every YouTube video interview of Steven Pinker. Because, and it's not even so much the stuff that he has to say about men and women, or even just heredity and or heritability and human nature as a function of genetics or a function of evolution, but some of the things that he has said that, like, I hadn't heard anybody say necessarily, but that I always kind of figured, like the fact that the cost of reacting to a false alarm is always less than the cost of not reacting to a real emergency. And therefore, we have a tendency to overreact even to false alarms. Those kinds of things. There's a great deal to be understood about who we are from just listening to him and reading his stuff. And I should probably, Simon Baron Cohen, I should probably really post a whole ton of links to a whole ton of stuff somewhere, and I suppose I might get to that someday, but I don't have one as yet. I'm very lazy that way. I'm sorry.
Do you have any others? Okay. All right. I've got a few more. Let's see here. How would you respond to the argument that we cannot have equality between the sexes because civilization monogamy is incompatible with liberated female sexuality, with books like J.D.'s Unwin's Sex and Culture being cited as supporting data?
Well, I would be able to more authoritatively answer this question if I'd ever read that book. Okay, here's the thing. Humans have an extremely unique and strange reproductive model. Monogamy is, whether it's lifelong or serial, monogamy, the way we do it, is completely different from the way other monogamous primates do it, at least monogamous social primates who live in groups. And because of that, I think that what a lot of books, a lot of researchers tend to do is they tend to take a sort of a reductionist. We are really meant to be promiscuous, or we evolved to be promiscuous, and it's just social constructs that imposed monogamy. I don't think that that's the case at all. I think that reproductive choices over and over and over and over and over again, naturally selected for our particular brand of monogamy, which is dominant in every culture, even those that allow polygamy. So there are every single civilization on the planet engages in monogamy as its predominant form of, as its predominant reproductive model. An egalitarian monogamy, which means that it's not just the dominant pair, the alpha male and the alpha female, who get to hook up and have kids. No, everybody can do it if they can manage it, right? This is unique to humans in the primate world. It's a completely innovative thing, right? And where there is multiple partners, it is almost overwhelmingly polygyny, right? One male and multiple female mates, right? This is because that is, in my opinion, the model where we came from, right? And so there are lingering vestiges of that. You will very, very rarely see a society, an advanced society, a society that is beyond the hunter-gatherer stage or the most primitive agrarian stage that engages in polyandry as a norm, right? I don't think that female sexual liberation, I don't think we evolved I don't think that evolution gave us processes or gave us traits in which that is favored, where women want to be particularly promiscuous or as promiscuous as men can be. You see this in studies of gay men and lesbians, right? The most promiscuous gay men have partners in the thousands over their lifetimes. The most promiscuous gay lesbian women have partners in the, you know, almost 100 in their lifetimes. There's a reason for that. There's no reason to think that liberating women completely sexually and giving them their choices completely consequence-free, you know, so no pregnancy, no STDs, no shame, no social censure, right, is going to result in the same sexual choices that men make. I mean, there's no reason to believe that. Because men and women are different. They've always had different reproductive strategies. They've always had different costs and benefits regarding reproduction. So, like, I don't understand why anybody would think that if women were free from all restraint, social, legal, everything, right, biological, that they would behave like men. They won't. They just won't.
Yeah. All right. Let's see here. Okay. What course of action could is being used to clear the education system of ideologies? Oh, can you guys hear me? Hello. Hello.
I'm thinking.
Okay.
Okay. What could we use to rid the education system of ideologies? Same thing that could rid the house that I own in BC of all of its problems. You burn it down and collect the insurance money and start from scratch. The ideologies, the thought processes, like Don Dutton's talk that Cafe recently posted, he said basically, you have a paradigm. You have a paradigm about domestic violence. You don't know it, but you do. You have an ideology about domestic violence. You don't know it, but you do, because it's what you've been exposed to, right? And this is really the thing when it comes to everything, to social work, to education, to all of these things, right? Once, even when you get rid of the policies, you could get rid of the policies, you could get rid of all of the training, you could just basically say, just use your own judgment. These people have already been raised and educated, the people who are working in those industries have been raised and educated within an ideology, and they will continue to apply it, at least until, well, at least most of them, right, until there's something else to replace it. And replacing an ideology, it ain't going to be easy. It's really not going to be a whole lot of fun. I would almost think that the one thing that could break the ideology in primary education would be a movement toward homeschooling, right? But that would have to be something that would put a dent in public primary education. So, I mean, like, I don't know. Once it's there, it's so hard. It's like an infestation of fruit flies. It just takes one, and then they're impossible to get rid of. So I don't know how. Just burn it down. Just burn it all down. I don't know. It just, how do you convince people that a complete revamping is necessary? So.
Wow, that's really nihilistic.
Well, I mean, it is, but I mean, like, what are you going to do? You can't make incremental change because, well, in my opinion, you can't make incremental change because the way the system is set up, because it is so top-down, because it is so embroiled in formal policy and best practices and all of these things, right? And then those have all been internalized by the people working within the system, that you will just have things going back just on their own to where they were anytime you make a little change. And then just it almost seems like you would need to just scrap the whole thing and rebuild it. The way the New Zealand schools in that study did with recess, right? The four schools that were brave enough to take on the potential legal liability of participating in the study and said, okay, we're not only going to eliminate rules at recess, we're actually going to sort of eliminate supervision at recess. And then they had a drastic decrease in the number of injuries in children and in the amount of bullying. When they just let kids play without adults intervening and imposing rules on them, right? So, you know, but it takes that kind of insane thinking, and our society is so so litigious, and there things are so sensitive. I mean, like with Gamergate, I mean, on the one hand, it's good that 150 angry letters to Intel got them to pull out a Gamasutra or a Kotaku or whatever it was, their advertising campaign, right? But that was just 150 angry letters, right? So all it would take to, you know, get the school system to get back in line, right, would be 150 angry letters, 150 people rattling their sabers, and then they'll get back in line and do what the feminists tell them. So, I mean, it things are so hypersensitive to these kinds of things, and people are so so terrified of disapproval. They're terrified of public censure. They're terrified of litigation. They're terrified of all of these things. it seems like an impossible mission to change something as big as a school system. You know, how do you even get rid of zero tolerance policies? You know, is that even possible?
Yeah. Well, it is a tricky situation. It's sometimes disheartening to see just how much things need to change. And since we're almost at the end of it, I thought I would bring up one final question from the patron chat. Again, this is obviously to Karen. And BR asks, what is the best way to chain a woman to a waffle iron?
By her hair. I don't know if you see the self-interest in that comment. but definitely by her hair. Attach her by her hair. Just braid her hair. Should be a foot long at least. And then just attach the chain to her braid, and there you go. Because that means that I could never be chained to a waffle iron, so I don't even own a waffle iron. I haven't made waffles since I worked at a pancake house as a cook. And frankly, we use the same batter for pancakes and for waffles, just FYI. You're not getting anything special when you order waffles, just letting you know.
Failed waffle plus gravy experiment. And that you actually originally made the suggestion to him, so he thought he would come back to you after apparently, you know, failed attempts to successfully chain a woman to waffle iron. I imagine that doesn't really work, because a woman could just, even if you're successful in chaining a woman to a waffle iron, you probably can just walk away with the waffle iron and your waffles. So, you know, it's not something that seems very, very advantageous. But yeah, thank you for that, BR.
One of the things too about chaining people to things, is if you chain them to something that they can carry around with them, they just get stronger, right? So you chain a woman to a waffle iron, it's basically like wearing ankle weights or wearing, you know, a backpack full of sand or something like that to make her stronger, or, you know, increase her endurance and just make her more able to match you. So, I mean, really, it's counterproductive on your part. I mean, if you want to keep her weak and keep her submissive, I wouldn't really chain her to anything. I would just like probably berate her and tell her that, like, she's like a pathetic inferior woman and all of those things that us misogynists say about women.
Well, on a daily basis,
and just convince her that, and then there you go.
It's simpler than that, though.
You won't even have to tie her to the waffle iron; she'll just stay there.
If you just tell her she's oppressed, she'll just do the work herself.
There you go. There you go. Just tell her she's a slave, and then she'll be a slave. And then, you know, if she's not convinced by that, then she's not the woman for you, maybe. Because it should really be that easy. It should just take like, I don't know, like an hour or two of microaggressions to really convince her that she's subjugated and to keep her in her place. So, yeah, if she doesn't conform to that, if she doesn't comply with that, then I don't know, she might be one of those uppity women who, like, thinks for herself and stuff. Which would be a real shame, because the feminists can't use a woman like that.
If she doesn't see how she is oppressed by the waffle iron and therefore can't ever lead the waffle iron, and the waffle iron is actually acting upon her and weighs 200 pounds, and she is a victim of it, and There's just nothing, you know, there's nothing she can do, except maybe appeal to a man to save her from the waffle iron. You know, so she can't actually. She can't even leave. Leave the waffle iron.
Okay, well, but if she's going to appeal to a man to save her from the waffle iron, that just means you need to really look at her, like, text messages and stuff. You need to snoop into her Facebook and things like that. Because she's probably looking for a man to save her from the waffle iron. It's just a mess all around. I would suggest maybe just ask her nicely if she'd make you some waffles. And if she does, that would be great. And if she doesn't, maybe you guys could just go out for waffles.
I'm waiting for you to mute. I know the silences in this particular one have been a little bit painful in the echoing, but
yeah.
Continue or end. So I apologize for that. Technical difficulties. We'll look into Karen.
Well, Allison, this is just breakfast culture in action. You know that?
Yeah, it's breakfast culture.
It's getting pretty sticky.
It's crepe culture.
Crepe.
Oh my god, that was excellent. And with that, I think
it's time
to usher us out. So I will help Rachel with that one. Do if you are interested in the shirts and seeing Karen ride a bomb. Basically wearing a pair of Daisy Dukes and a cut-off shirt in commemoration of Shirt Storm. Of course, preferentially go buy the infamous shirts in question, but if you like the idea of purchasing my drawing of Karen riding a bomb, please can go to the link that I'll ask Karen to put in the low bar and do purchase that shirt. And we have a few left of the 20 that we need pre-ordered, and I've asked Karen if she'll sign them, and without me having to chain her to anything, and she's reluctantly agreed that she'll sign the first 20. So get one, now. And we also have a lovely design from Rachel. It is Hello Badger. It's very adorable. So if you have a budding badger in your life and you want a shirt for Christmas for that young badger, who you probably don't let listen to the show, I would hope. But anyway, do consider buying one of those. And again, the link will be in the low bar as soon as I convince Karen to do it. And hopefully that doesn't involve chaining her to anything.
Or just polite. Even if you're a man who's very comfortable in your sexuality. I still want the shirt anyway.
Or if you're a man who likes cute things, and to be quite honest, I think most men like cute things, because otherwise women would be out on their ear, because we're not that cute. We're only marginally cute. We would be totally superseded by babies and kittens. But because men are so responsive to cute, they'll even respond to it in a hairy, smelly adult female human. So there you go. That's my little rant for the day, and I don't know where I was going with that. Now it's just complete bullshit, so let's just end this. Thank you. Buy a shirt.
Buy a shirt.
Bye.
Bye-bye, guys. And, yeah, I will be signing those against my will. Allison's forcing me. She's totally not respecting my boundaries or my consent, but I will sign the first 20 shirts. So go ahead, and I will even overcome my laziness and put the link in the low bar. So, good night, everybody, and thanks, Rachel and Allison, for fielding the questions and finding them and reading them out to me, and I hope everything went okay, and there you go. All right. Bye, guys.